This presentation is a culmination of my senior project where I researched Major League Baseball marketing and how and if it relates to Baltimore Orioles' success or lack thereof. So, next slide, Ryan. So, I want to talk first a little bit about my inspiration. When I was 8 years old, I went with my dad to visit his favorite hometown baseball team, the Boston Red Sox. I fell in love with the team, I fell in love with the audience, the crowd, and the sport. And growing up in Baltimore, I've kind of realized there's huge differences between the Orioles and the Red Sox, specifically in their stadiums. So, for example, the Red Sox didn't have a hot dog run on the screen between innings. They didn't have a playground for kids to go play at, and they definitely didn't have a kiss cam. All they had was Neil Diamond's famous Sweet Caroline during the eighth inning stretch, and other well-timed music cues. So I wanted to research why they were different. Everything on the professional level comes from a very distinct decision. And I wanted to know why each teams have different amenities in their stadium, in their marketing ideals, and frankly, in the way they each approach winning. So, right. So, I'm just gonna give a quick breakdown of baseball, very quick, about the things that you might need to know for this presentation. So, first of all, baseball is considered the oldest sport, being played for over 120 years in the country, and it is currently in 2017 in a $9.5 billion business. Second, there are 30 teams across the country. Some cities or areas have two teams, like Chicago, New York, San Francisco, and the Maryland area, with Washington and Baltimore. Third, a baseball team makes most of their revenue from the combination of ticket sales, from merchandise and stadium food sales. One huge source of revenue, though, a team also has is from their TV deals, which can range in size and length. So the Los Angeles Dodgers have a $200 million TV deal right now that's going on for the next 25 years, whereas the Orioles are making only $47 million. So big difference between the two, and that's the main source of revenue. So, next. So I want to talk quickly about brands. Brands in baseball. I lost my slide. Here we go. The Red Sox are an iconic brand, first of all, especially in the 90s and 2000s when they hadn't won a championship in 80-some years. And they were known for their trash-talking and smash-mouth style. They were just really famous in that way. The Cubs were another one, deemed as one of the people I talked to who said, a lovable loser. And it's the kind of brand they've sold. On the other side, the Marlins and Athletics are forgettable and often forgotten franchises who never seem to seriously compete or draw serious crowds year in and year out. Next slide. So where do the Orioles fall in that? In March of this year, an Emory professor named Michael Lewis created his annual fan marketing report. He uses three main rankings for each team: fan equity, social equity, and road equity. Fan equity assesses the level of passion or engagement in local fan base. This is measured by looking at sales of merchandise, attendance, and other things. Local income and population is taken into account in that statistic. Social equity measures the potential fan involvement. This looks at social media followers, visitors to team websites, and trending internet searches. So basically how many people are paying attention to your team. And the last, road equity provides a metric of passion beyond the local market. So people saying, I love the Red Sox, or people saying, I hate the Yankees. And so on this scale, out of 30 teams, the Orioles scored 18th for fan equity, 21st for social equity, and 16th for road equity. And Ryan, could you just press the button? So they placed 19th overall out of 30 teams for their total fans, which is below average. So that's where they sit, and now I'm going to dive just a little deeper into what that means. So this is the Orioles' history. And I made my scale from 1952 2017, because in 1952, that's when the team moved from St. Louis to Baltimore, and that's when Baltimore Orioles history really began. One thing that's kind of forgotten is that really, as I said up there, in the mid-60s to mid-80s, the Orioles were a very solid team. And people forget they really truly had a foundation of winning, which is really important to a team's long-term success. But, you know, as I said, in 18 years, they made the playoffs. They made the playoffs 8 times, they won the World Series 3 times, and they had a lot of success. In the 34 years since 1983, they've only made the playoffs 5 times. And you can see that I put a little line for what a solid season might be, and they really haven't reached that since 1983 consistently. So, and this is talking about strength of fans. So In 2014, that same Emory professor that created the study that I talked about before, Michael Lewis, and his coworker, Manoj Tripathi, he created two new statistics. They measured the sensitivity that fans of certain teams have to success in a given season using statistical models of consumer demand, or as they put it, attendance. They found Orioles fans to be second most sensitive to wins or losses. That means the Baltimore fans demand their team to supply wins or they won't go at all. In another stat in the same study, they find Orioles fans to be third most sensitive to prices. So the cheaper the ticket, the more likely they are to go. The more expensive, the less likely they are to go. And I think it's pretty fair to say that a long-standing but still fresh memory of losing influenced all of this. Because the team consistently let fans down, why should fans want to go? And why should I go to see a losing team for anything more than dirt cheap prices? I think both of those ideas are valid, and I'll come back to that on a later slide. So this is, I think, just kind of interesting, a strength and fans comparison. You have the Red Sox on the same timeline on the left, and the Yankees on the right. The Yankees are a juggernaut with so much money. I mean, look, that's 4 million fans a year they got in 2005, 2007. That's just absurd. I can't even fathom that. And the Red Sox, I just thought was interesting, because compared to the other two, it's really a pretty straight line. And they're consistently around upper 2 million. So this is per year. I thought that was really interesting, just to compare where the Orioles are. So,
right.
And this is talking a little bit about market size. So in 2018, Marylanders have essentially four teams to pick from to cheer for. They can cheer for the O's, they can cheer for the Washington Nationals, they can cheer for the Pittsburgh Pirates or the Philadelphia Phillies. Depending on what part of Maryland you're from, it might be easier to pick a team, of course. But prior to 2005, the Orioles owned Southern Maryland. Now, I say 2005 because Washington moved from Montreal to Washington and became the Washington Nationals in 2005, essentially destroying the Orioles' Southern Maryland fan base. Now, I want to go back. Could you go back two slides to slide seven? You can see in 2005, when the Nationals moved here, they were already on the decline. But it really pushed them down continually, and their winning did not help. So a combination of winning, or lack thereof, losing, and the Nationals moving in really hurt them. So I thought that was pretty interesting. And then can you go two slides back? Okay, yeah. I thought this was also interesting. You could barely see the Orioles up there. Between the Nationals, Philly, and the Pirates, they're completely surrounded, and they're just a tiny, tiny part of them. The map, they kind of have Eastern Maryland, kind of have Western Maryland, but really small. This is from the New York Times in an article they published 2 years ago. So yeah, can you go to the next?
Yeah.
So this is talking about payroll. So Peter Angelos bought the team in 1992, he bought the team. And for the next 10 years or so, they acted like a small market team, like I showed they were on slide nine. They spent very low amount of money, but even so, in 2005, you can see they kind of took it up. They were losing, they knew the Washington Nationals were moving in, they wanted to get more talent, they wanted to try to turn the team around, they wanted to win. And it did work, they kept losing, and so they stopped. They said, alright, we're gonna be done with this. And for the next 10 years or so, it climbed steadily as the average payroll climbed as well. But in 2014, the Orioles surprised everyone and did pretty well. And so they spent more. And they climbed to 2015, they climbed to 2016, and now they're acting like a fairly large market team. I mean, I think the stat was $167 million was their payroll last year. That's ridiculous. That's a lot of money. And that's out of their normal market size. So it's interesting that they've really tried to break out of this losing streak and worked on winning. I read a recent study that gave legitimate proof that the more you spend on players, the more you'll win. Kind of makes sense. The more talent you pay for, the more talent you have. So I'm kind of slamming the Orioles for everything bad about them, but I have nothing on Camden Yards. Camden Yards is absolutely amazing. Camden Yards was built in 1994, I believe, and it has consistently been one of the top three stadiums in the country every year. Another interesting thing is its influence over 12 other stadiums that have been built around the league. So people really love the combination of classic with the warehouse with kind of modern. I personally love Camden Yards because how wide open it is. Often you feel in baseball stadium you're like climbing through tunnels. And I go to Fenway Park and it feels like you're kind of in an anthill. But Camden Gardens, the concourses are huge. And the other really interesting thing is that their food is really diverse, but also kind of home to Baltimore. I love getting crab fries. So I think Orioles Stadium at Camden Gardens is really, really a great thing, and definitely helped the Orioles. So marketing. The Orioles marketing aren't idiots. They know what's going on. But it's really difficult for me to gauge how much success their marketing has had on their team. Even so, I can definitely conclude that the Orioles marketing is doing everything they possibly can. Every Friday, for example, is a student deal night. Every Sunday, kids run the bases for free. Throughout the week, there are bobbleheads and giveaways and theme nights. I went to a Star Wars night a few weeks ago. It was super fun, and the fireworks after it were really cool. Their goal has been to seriously maximize the family entertainment aspect of the stadium experience. They even have a day where you can bring a dog. I mean, that's crazy, bring a dog to a ballpark. That's wild. So for the Red Sox, for comparison, they have a bobblehead and memorabilia giveaways maybe once a month. No student deals, no fireworks. They really just sell baseball. And that's what the Red Sox do. They sell a good baseball team, whereas the Orioles sell a good night at Camden Yards. And so it's really important to kind of distinguish that. And that's why the Orioles kind of built the new Kids Corner up there. I looked at that and I first thought that was ridiculous. Why would you want a Kids Corner in an Orioles? In a baseball stadium, but they're trying to sell to the kids, they're trying to sell to the families, and that's the goal of theirs. And I think it's really smart. So, next slide. So, given what we know about the payroll, given what we know about their recent success, and given what we know about the sensitivity the Orioles fans have to prices and record, it makes sense that the Orioles are trying to win now. They've upped their payroll. They're saying, we need to win. I mean, what would you do if you knew that no one's come to your beautiful stadium all summer? What would you do if you knew that your team wasn't really going to win? If you kept it the same way it was going, you would try to win now. You would really try to win now. So has it worked out? Could you just press the button? No, it has not worked. Last year, they ran a negative $26 million operating loss, which means they literally lost $26 million. In comparison, the Cubs made $100 million. So, the Cubs have a great brand and they know how to market it well. The Orioles spend a lot and didn't get enough back. And so far this year, they have 17 wins out of 55 games. So they're not, it didn't work is the point. And while I agree with the effort, it might be time to turn it around. And they're really primed for a change. So, next slide. So, I'm 18, I'm graduating high school. I have no idea how to run an MLB franchise. But I have some suggestions if I were to meet with Peter Angelos there on the bottom. I have some things I would tell him. I look him in the eyes, and I would tell him these things. I say, A, if Dan Duquette, their general manager, doesn't fully commit himself to rebuilding and making sure that the long term is stronger than the short term, fire him and find someone he can. And that's B. B is find someone who knows how to lead a franchise more than just a team and knows the intricacy of our city and the problems that we may face. Third, cut costs at every corner. You saw negative $26 million was not healthy. No team can run that. No team wants to run that. Stop thinking about 2020, or stop thinking about 2018 and start thinking about 2020, 2021, long term. So I'd say save at every possible chance you have. And lastly, I recently spoke with a marketing officer at Heinz Marketing. They run the marketing for the Seattle Mariners, for Baseball Hall of Fame, and a bunch of other minor league baseball teams. And the one thing that he tried to get across to me was that the most important thing for a losing team is to create relationships inside of your city. Create relationships with restaurants, with nonprofits, and with other organizations that might need your help. Now, the Orioles are doing a great job at this. I've seen them around the city a lot, and their name has been on a lot of fundraisers, been on a lot of different types of projects around the city. But they really need to keep doing that and hold on to those relationships for dear life, because then those people will help them in the long run in helping them to become appreciated again. So, Ryan, that was my presentation on the Orioles marketing. I want to briefly talk about my process of creating it. I spent a lot of time researching in the first few days, first few weeks, and then recently I reached out to a lot of people. Doc Rongel gave me some names. I reached out to an alum named Drew McPhail, and he currently works with the Los Angeles Dodgers as a director of player development, which is awesome. I reached out to a few other people in the Orioles department and people that I knew might help out. I got back a lot less than I reached out, which is expected. And some challenges I faced, as I said, were the Orioles and all Major League Baseball is private equity. They don't share their financial details. So I had to rely a lot on Forbes, and I had to rely a lot on other people who had more access to information than I did. And also I'm a geek for baseball, so it was easy to go down kind of baseball wormholes that weren't important to my presentation. So I had to stay away from those. And then the next slide are just my sources. You can just click through. I'd love to open up for questions if anybody has one. If you don't, that's okay. That's my presentation. So thank you guys.
The Cubs were so bad for so long, yet they seemed to sustain a bunch of interest. And now, like, the Orioles are kind of are tanking. Not nearly as long as the Cubs tanked, but like, what? I'm just wondering what could be some of the differences between why were people in that Chicago area who had two teams to choose from still diehard for the Cubs?
Yeah.
You know, even though they were doing so bad, and why?
ESPN 30 for 30 did a really amazing podcast on this exact kind of topic called Wrigleyville. And I listened to that when I was doing research for this. Wrigley Field, their stadium, is one of the oldest, like Fenway Park is, but they were really unique in the way that they didn't have lights until 1982. And that created this kind of stigma that Wrigley Field was a place to go for a day game. It was to have fun, it was a family place. And kids and parents would love to send their kids out just for the day to go to the game. Doesn't matter if they win or lost, it was the Cubs, the Cubbies, as they put it. And so that kind of day game attitude really changed and differentiated themselves with other teams in the way that it was just fun, just a thing to do in the afternoon. You didn't have to go to the game at night, you just went in the day. And that's carried over because that kind of young generation that went to all those games when they were young keeps going, it keeps providing them support. So I think that's definitely one reason. You're right. I mean, I looked at it, it was crazy. The Cubs in the last 40 years had 18 winning seasons, and they increased their attendance year to year 27 times, which is wild. I don't know how that happens, but it's definitely part of the stadium and part of the culture that they built. And it wasn't a winning culture, but it was a love for the team culture.
Well, that's what I was kind of wondering too, because, like, you know, you mentioned the A's as having a weak brand, but like in the 70s, you know, that wasn't a weak brand, and they were, I don't remember if they won the World Series, like when they had Reggie Jackson, and, you know, I mean, that was like a cool thing to like have some baseball cards from, you know, A's teams, but they haven't done that well either, and so they're now they're seeing more like, they seem more like Baltimore is now.
One of the, on the map that I showed you, on the markets, it was really interesting on that. Yeah, you can just go through. I thought it was so interesting, oh, it kind of cut off.
Yeah.
They didn't even show the Athletics. They didn't even show the Athletics.
Yeah, I saw the Giants, but I didn't see.
The Giants took over all of the Oakland, San Francisco area, which was crazy. And the Giants have had enormous success in the last 10 years with, like, what is it, like 3 championships, 5, maybe 6 visits to the World Series, and they've completely destroyed the Oakland market because Oakland has been dead for the last 20 years. And it's, you know, that's one reason why. Especially when you have those two teams to pick from, it's so much easier to just change.
Or like, it seems like Baltimore, like we're losing some people who were around when the team was. But like, it's hard to get that great interest to your kids or your grandkids or whatever.
Yeah.
You know, if they just keep being losing. Losers.
In terms of the Baltimore audience, you said they were sensitive to price and to winning and losing. So did you do any research about our sort of commitment to the Ravens and if there's any difference between our, you know, loyalty to the Ravens versus the Orioles? Mm-hmm.
I didn't, but I know that, well, the interesting thing about the Orioles and NFL in general is that the NFL versus Major League Baseball, NFL doesn't have, or MLB doesn't have a cap of the amount of money they can spend. So that means that small market teams and big market teams are on completely different playing fields. So the Orioles are a small market team, and they can't spend as much money as maybe the Nationals, who are a big market team. And that puts the Orioles at a huge disadvantage. Whereas the Redskins, who are in Washington, Baltimore Ravens, are on the same playing field. And so they're able to spend the same money just going toward different things. And so the strategy plays a lot more in NFL, Ravens, versus Redskins. Fan attendance-wise, I didn't do that kind of research. I don't know their attendance. The Orioles are much worse than the Ravens have been in recent history. The Ravens are pretty much contenders every year. And so it definitely helps the attendance. And in general, football is more appreciated than baseball. So I don't have the stats for that, but that's what I assume.
So let me, because I got a scoop. I was out of the room, so I may have missed it, but when did Peter Angelos come to Baltimore?
I was either 1992 or 1994. I think it was 1994, because I think the stadium was built in 92. And then 94, he bought it.
Because he appears to me to be just awful.
Yeah.
And I think, to me, like, zero use for him. And so, and I'm sort of interested, right? Because I'm a diehard Red Sox fan. And I've lived in Baltimore for 34 years. I have no allegiance. Zero. Sorry, Jim. Since I have no allegiance to the O's, I've always been a Red Sox fan. And both of my kids are Red Sox fans. So, interesting, you know, the great idea on your part, I think. But boy, it goes deep.
It's interesting you say that.
But you're a Patriots fan too, right?
I'm a Red Sox. Yeah, Celtics. Yeah,
but
Bruins.
I'll give you the other way. I grew up a New York Mets fan, and I came here, and I'm an Orioles fan. Mm-hmm. But I find it very interesting that fans are fair weather fans here.
Yeah.
I didn't ever think that. I thought they weren't. I thought we were really a baseball town.
It's interesting you say that about Angelos. I did a little research on him too. And when he first bought the team, he became extremely popular. Because there was a big the player walkouts where
mm-hmm.
they just demanded they weren't going to get paid, or they weren't going to play unless they got paid fairly and were treated with equal rights as other unions. And Peter Angelos basically came out and said that I'm not going to field another team unless they get paid and they get what they want. I'm not going to bend down. And other managers or other owners hated him for that. But he got written up as a hero because it was kind of a savior of the collar, and Baltimore loved him. And then over time, he's become more involved in player decisions that haven't been the best, and kind of always over the shoulder of the general manager, and then his popularity is waning off. So I thought it was interesting that when he first bought the team, maybe 3-4 years, he was super popular just because of that one thing and from his lawyer background, but then it's totally waned off, and now he's very disliked. I haven't done research on his kids, but apparently they're starting to take a larger role
mm-hmm.
in the organization too. I was going to ask something about that, but I just didn't.
I was going to ask that question. So his two sons,
yeah.
and I think, you know, one was going to do sort of the legal end of things and the business part, and the other was going to do the baseball operation. They seem to be sort of switching roles right now, but
I've heard people say that they're excited for the two sons to come in.
But as a young, you know, fan or whatever, knowledgeable, what would you advise? I mean, so I think they fell into this trap of, oh, we're close to winning. If we just get fill these couple pieces, and they went out and tried to fill that with like veteran players, and it didn't work. What do you do? Do you just start fresh? Do you just let everybody go who's worth anything, basically, and rebuild? Or do you try to hold on to a couple key pieces and build around them?
Well, this is really interesting, and this is definitely more on the baseball side than marketing side, but in 2005, the strategy was to just take on as much talent as you could and kind of sign veteran players and spend as much money. Now, you see, ever since maybe 2010, when the Astros and the Cubs started, they just totally bring in so much youth. They throw all of their players out, they are terrible for 2 years, and they trade for as much prospects as they can. And they fill their whole minor league system with prospects. And then you see, 5 years down the road, you get what we have now, which is the Cubs are one of the best teams in baseball. The Astros are one of the best teams in baseball. They have these kids that are like 23, 24, and they're just amazing because they got all of them by selling their team away. And it's hard to do that, and everyone's doing that now. The White Sox are doing that. Who else is doing that? Yeah, the White Sox are definitely doing it, and they're right in the bad part right now, but they'll be good soon. I personally am a fan of rebuilding and pushing all of the big contracts away and going into kind of hibernation mode. But it's hard because, you know, no one's going to come if they do that. If they're bad, no one's going to come. And you're going to see it get into single digit or,
people also want
thousands.
The names. They want the Mannings. They want
Definitely. You got to have people
Chris
to market.
Right.
Definitely.
We couldn't get anybody until, like, J.J. Hardy signed,
right.
And then they started getting a couple people. But, I still watch every night. Painful. I'm still watching.
Oh, that's another thing. comment I have. The regular person can no longer watch this, these games. And this is totally wrong. It used to be on
PBAL. You mean TV watching?
Yeah. Yep. It's only on cable, on Masson. And that was a bad, I don't know if it's every team. I don't know if you did anything with that.
I didn't, but I know that Peter Angelos owns Masson.
Oh, no wonder. But still, that's taking it away from people that, I only have regular TV.
Yeah.
I only have, you know, those how many channels. And that was so wrong for them to take that America's pastime away from America. I don't know if everybody else does it.
Right. Well, in football's, you know, CBS, Fox, NBC.
Yeah.
Right.
They can buy those rights. So.
Right.
Versus local television by each team.
Right.
Yeah. Yeah. Anybody else? Any other questions?
No, this is great. Did you have fun?
I had a blast. I'm so glad about this stuff. I love this stuff.
I was here on Star Wars night too.
I was also.
Yeah.
We came all. Ryan, you did a good job.
Thanks.
Next time I know you'll buy the Star
Wars. Welcome.
Wingman.